So, chapter 9. Chapter 9. Removing the limits. So, the purpose of the central bank is to remove the limits on credit expansion. Usually, the central bank is government-owned, or historically it was government-owned, but later on, when everybody understood that when the government owns the bank, things don't work well and properly, central banks became to be independent. And independence is only in name. Central banks are never independent. Central banks are always dependent by the government. Central banks are created with laws by the government. The government at any point in time can change the law. The most banker, central bank board of directors or whoever is managing the central bank are usually appointed by the government itself, which simply means that at any point in time, if these guys, meaning the central bank, does not serve the government will replace them and put people who will serve the government. So, the first goal or purpose, let's see, purpose goals, will be to, of the central bank, to finance government deficits. This is the same as government financing. So, this is the first priority of the central bank. And the second priority is finance / bailout commercial banks. Most of the time, the central bank is the commercial banks, by the commercial banks, for the commercial banks, so it is a servant of the commercial bank. It's usually commercial banks get together to establish their own central bank, which will regulate everybody. What the regulation is? The regulation is focused on removing the limits of credit expansion. In other words, regulation will be first and foremost on making commercial banks expand together uniformly. So if they all grow at 10%, there will not be leakage from one bank to another. They can grow together safely. Okay? So, that's what the central bank. The central bank is there not to allow one bank to grow at 5% and another one to grow at 45%. That doesn't work. That's kind of like the free market and cannot be allowed. That's what the central bank is about, okay? Of course, one of the major functions of the central bank is to monopolize printing of money and to remove any competing currencies. Another core function of the central bank is to, if they can and when they can, or as soon as they can, to demonetize gold. The word demonetize, monetize, comes from the word moneta, which means money, money. To demonetize means to remove as functioning from money. So, to demonetize gold means that the central bank will do everything in its power to remove gold functioning as money. They may probably outlaw it, or they may just have a massive propaganda just telling them gold is no good, or it's ancient money, or that only tribes and uncivilized people use gold. You know, they'll tell whatever story will work for the people to not use gold, because bankers, both central and commercial, don't like gold. Gold is a massive weapon against both of them. It works against their interest. It works against their profits, okay? So, as I said, bankers hate gold. But equally important, gold also prevents or limits commercial bank or central bank financing of the government. So, governments also hate gold. Governments just want paper money so that they can just print as much as they want to print. You want to print a billion? Fine. You want to print a trillion? Fine. No problem. So, when the crisis of, we call this global financial crisis of 2008 came, the balance sheet of the central bank was about 1 trillion. And that will be 1 trillion balance sheet, which was accumulated in a matter of 100 years. The Federal Reserve was established in 1913, so in about 95 years of history, they had 9 trillion. Then the second trillion, they printed in 3 months to bail out the banks. So here it's 95 years. Now, other less important and very low priority goals, other low priority goals, for the central bank are, and they say, oh, we always fight inflation. So, inflation meaning low inflation. So banks want or try to keep inflation low as possible, while they're financing the governments and taking care of the commercial banks. In other words, these are high priority, these are low priority. Again, very high inflation is in general damaging for the banking system, is in general damaging for the government. And if you remember, high inflation actually causes a whole bunch of problems, especially when demand for money falls. So, actually, a relatively higher priority is to keep demand for money up. In other words, they want to keep a relatively good priority. Now, here is confidence in money. That's a fairly high priority. If you got the hard confidence in money, you can do these things, okay? Confidence in money is relatively high. The next one is confidence in the banking system overall. They want to maintain confidence in the banking system. They always say the banking system is strong, the banking system is profitable, the banking system is good, there are no problems, everything's okay. So they'll keep saying all of those things all the time. And most of the time it will not be true. Now the example is about the Italian banking system, which is totally and completely bankrupt, where most of the banks are actually insolvent. They've accumulated 360 billion euros, $60 billion of bad debts, which they can't possibly pay, okay? Which is a huge amount of their overall credits. But nevertheless, they keep saying the same old thing, that the banking system is strong, that they are recovering from profitability, and whatever else. And the next one is stable currency. Stable
currency.
They don't want the exchange rate relative to other currencies to change too much. For example, the Chinese Central Bank, it's called PBOC, People's Bank of China, is trying to maintain a very or relatively stable exchange rate against the dollar. And if the Chinese currency starts going up, they'll push it a little bit down, okay, to reduce the movements. And if the Chinese currency starts going down, they'll try to drive it back up. Here's a simple picture. This is what the Chinese currency would like to do. Okay, this is on the free market, that's what it would do. And the Chinese Central Bank says, oh no, we're not going to allow such a big rise. And we're not going to allow such a big fall. We're going to keep it relatively stable. So instead of the free market fluctuation, which will be very high and very destabilizing, they prefer to have a relatively low fluctuation. So when we say stable currency, we mean stable exchange rate to other, relative to other major currencies. In other words, what's happening, the local currency to the Thai baht doesn't matter. It matters what happens to the local currency to the dollar, to the euro, to the yen, to the British pounds. These are the global major currencies of the world. So these are what the central banks typically tell us they want to do. This is what they typically try to do. But whenever there is a problem here, any of these will be always sacrificed to finance the government. So, if it means inflation will rise to finance the government, that's okay. If it means confidence in the money may be lost, that's okay. The government is always higher priority. If it means it will destabilize currency, that's okay. Alright? So, these are desires. And these are, okay, let's write it out. Desires. This is what they want. And these are imperative. Imperative means this is what they must do, and this is what they want to do. Okay. And this is what they tell us, and this is what they don't tell us. Well, sometimes they're actually very clear. Oh, we're going to do whatever it takes to save the banks. But they save and bail out the banks in the name of stable banking system. All right, let's see where we have. So, I already mentioned monopoly. One of the things is monopoly privilege for or of banknotes. So that's one of the main tools for the central bank to accomplish removing the limits is they must eliminate all competing currencies. That's the one thing. The second one is the power of law. You have to use the law. The central bank uses the law to regulate other banks. The central bank uses the law. In other words, if that's what I was explaining last time, if the banks get together and try to organize and try to cartelize, there will be always one or two banks willing to cheat and profit from the agreement. So when I get 10 banks together, if they all agree on something, there's always one or two banks that would like to cheat and profit from the agreement. This is what we see with OPEC all the time, when all OPEC countries want to lower produce of oil, production of oil, the supply of oil, drive the price significantly higher. But guess what? As soon as the price is higher, any OPEC country wants to pump up a lot more oil and profit from the higher price. But if one, two, three of them decide to profit from the higher price, they push the price lower. We call this cheating, okay? And in OPEC, nobody can enforce the cheating. That's why OPEC doesn't work, can't work, is always prone to failure. It's exactly the same as the competitive markets with commercial banks. You get 10, 20 banks, no matter what they agree on, there's always the temptation to cheat and profit at the expense of all the others. Well, they have done this over and over historically until enters the government, and the government uses laws and enforces the cheating. Okay? All forms of cheating, they're called regulation. The regulation's purpose is to keep banks from cheating and using free market techniques to profit from it. Okay? Again, to profit one bank at the expense of all the others. So the goal, when we use the law, is that the banks all profit together, not at the expense of each other, at the expense of the people, at the expense of households. Households get impoverished as a result of this. So the power of the law will include regulations, which are usually in the form of law, and legal tender law, which requires people to accept the government's, meaning the central bank's money, whether they like it or not, whether they want it or not. All right, let's see what else we have. And, of course, part of it, part of legal tender law is issue of money. That's the same monopoly privilege of banknotes. In other words, you have the power to print, but you're the only one, and no one else can do it. Okay, that's important privilege. All right, let's see what else we got in here. So the central bank functions first and foremost as the banker's bank. Banker's bank. Commercial banks will maintain deposits at the central bank. They'll maintain a deposit at the central bank. That deposit is called Fed funds. That's just the name. It's a weird name, but that's how they call it. Fed funds. In other words, these are funds of the central bank, funds of the Federal Reserve. Federal Reserve will be the U.S. central bank. And these deposits will have a function. The function, the purpose of these deposits is to serve as reserves. Reserves. They'll serve as reserves. Now, how does the central bank make all banks grow at the same time? So, if you're going to grow at 20%, we want you and everybody else to grow at 20%. We're one small family, which we all profit at the expense of everybody else. It's called required reserves. Required reserves. Required reserves. These are reserves which commercial banks are required to keep at the central bank. That's it. So, you gotta maintain 10%. You gotta maintain 10%, you gotta maintain 10%. all commercial banks have to maintain the same required reserves. Okay. Now, the required reserves relative to the assets. I know playing with the phone is a disease. Okay, it's very, very addictive. Okay, a lot of people. That's a, you know, it's a whole different thing. They can't stay even for 5 minutes away from the phone. You know, something may happen. You know, something would happen, and you wouldn't know within 5 minutes, right? You gotta be on the phone all the time, right? I guess. All right. So this required reserves is expressed in ratio. So it's called the required reserves ratio. And is usually nicely shortened as RRR, required reserves ratio. This is the percentage of required reserves which commercial banks must maintain at the central bank. The percentage of required reserves. Now, the reserve ratio from last chapter will determine what? The reserve ratio will determine what? Will determine the multiplier. This will determine the multiplier. Now, when we say required, remember how I define required is the minimum. Okay, now the reserve ratio, if this is the minimum, no, this determines the multiplier. If this will determine in return the maximum multiplier. So, if the required reserves are more than 10%, that's very important to understand. It's actually amazingly simple. The multiplier will be what? What's the multiplier? Less than 10. Correct. Less than 10. Very easy. If the required reserves is 5%, then multiplier is less than 5. And if another example, the required reserves are, why right here, 5? This is 20 bucks. That would make a mistake. Now, this right here, 5%. Then the multiplier is less than 20. Okay. Well, what did we say, or what is important to understand? And it's used in the textbook, is we say that the banks are loaned up. What means to loan up? To loan up means to loan up to the maximum. You loan up as much as you can. So you loan up to the required reserve ratio. So, what we know is that maximum profits are attained when a commercial bank is loaned up. In other words, profits come from revenues. And revenues come from interest on loans. Okay? So, let's write it up. If loans go up, this means interest revenue go up, it means profit goes up. So, if you want maximum profits, you're going to maximize your revenues, and you maximize your revenues by more loans, by maximizing your loans. So, loaning up means, implies, maximum profitability. Implies maximum profitability for the commercial bank.
Okay.
That's loaning up. So, what we know is then it follows maximum profitability. Loaning up also means maximum multiplier. So, what this simply means that is the following. If commercial banks want to maximize their profits, they must loan up. And loaning up means that if the required reserve is 10%, they'll multiply at 10 times.
Okay?
So, essentially, the required rate of reserves by commercial banks choosing to loan up determines the exact multiplier. So, in a competitive banking system with a central bank and a required rate of reserve, a required rate of 10% will equal to multiplier, sometimes we shorten it, I'm changing now the name to money multiplier, which I wrote last time, right? Money multiplier will equal 10. In other words, the money multiplier will be always less than 10, but in this case, it's just going to be equal to 10 as long as commercial banks are loaning up.
Okay.
And that's the required rate of, and if the required rate of reserves is 5% and commercial banks loan up, the money multiplier will be 20.
Okay.
So, the money multipliers I'll be explaining very soon, maybe not today, maybe next time, it's at the end of the chapter, determines the money supply, and I'll be getting to that. That's part of it. What's the question? Question. RRT? RRR?
INT.
Okay, that's interest. INT stands for interest, rev for revenue. That's interest revenue.
Okay.
Interest is the amount of money paid for borrowing.
Okay.
Alright, so that's an important consideration. The central bank, so now we're getting back to where I started and why I started this whole thing is very simple. If the central bank determines the required reserve ratio, let's say of 10%, this means that all banks will loan up 10 times.
Okay.
And if the central bank or somehow reserves increase by whatever percentage, by let's say 9%, all banks keep loaning up to the maximum, they will not be losing money to each other because they're all going to be loaned up. And whatever the reserves grow, they all will grow together, we'd say uniformly. Okay? That's because they are loaned up at all times. When commercial banks are loaned up at all times, they're all at the maximum. Whenever there is a reserve increase anywhere in the banking system, it will spread, the reserve will spread between the 10, 20, or 50 banks. It will spread and allow all banks to grow uniformly. In other words, you can inject reserves in one particular bank, and as I was explaining A, B, C, and D, the reserves will flow to B, to C, to D, and soon enough, they'll flow and spread equally to all commercial banks. So no matter what money enters the system, no matter where it enters the system, it will spread between the five banks, okay? And then they will loan up that extra reserves jointly at the same multiplier, at the same rate, and not losing reserves to each other. So that's what the central bank is doing with the required reserve ratio. The required reserve ratio ensures that the, well, that's not right, that the all commercial banks grow at the same time and don't lose reserves to each other. That's the first purpose of the required reserve ratio. The second purpose is that it simply introduces confidence or improves confidence in the banking system. Say, yes, our banks maintain 10% reserves. We have reserves, we're good, we are well regulated and all the other things. So it's good for confidence. But that's not the real general purpose of it. The real genuine purpose is ensuring harmonious growth. All right.
The money between the central bank and the bank use it.
Again?
Can the bank use it?
Okay, let's do that. That's a very good question. It's explained in the second half of this chapter, which means that I can do this now. All right, so first of all, what is the money supply? I'm going to be probably answering your question over the next 10 or 15 minutes because that's half the chapter. Money supply is equal to whatever the money reserves are, whatever the reserves are in the whole banking system, multiplied by the money multiplier. Okay. So, now we need to say what is the money multiplier. We already said that part. So, the reserves are in two forms. So, the reserves are held in cash. This is just the money that you have at the vault. In other words, when I go to the bank, hold the money at the ATM. The money at the ATM belongs to the bank. It's in the form of cash. And when I walk to the bank and ask for some cash, they give me some cash. They keep very little cash on hand. So, if they have a big balance sheet, let's say a whole bunch of loans, okay, and they have a required reserve of 10%, they'll keep in cash no more than 1%. The other 9%, they'll keep deposits at the Fed. How did we call this deposit at the Fed? The commercial bank's deposit at the Fed. How do we call it? Anywhere? Deposit at the bank is called Fed funds. Okay. So, Fed funds. Fed funds. Okay. Now, Fed funds, let's repeat and write it out, is a reserve. And now let's just repeat from the very beginning. What is a reserve? It's an asset that you keep. Okay? So, it's an asset that you cannot loan out. You must keep.
You keep, but in case you have bad debt, a lot of bad debt, then can you?
Okay. Now, about bad debt. Let's do this. Bad debt. What does it mean, bad debt? Bad debt means a debt which cannot be repaid or is not likely to be repaid. In other words, it's a loan which the commercial bank made but is not likely to get back. Okay? Now, you should have studied this and, well, not maybe not yet. I'll be explaining probably later on. Bad debt and loans are a loss to the bank. They are a loss. And losses, just like profits, go where? on the balance sheet. There is an income statement. So an income statement, you get the revenues, you're going to get expenses, but you also have profits and losses. Where do profits and losses go on the balance sheet? Again?
Capital.
Perfect answer. Now, we need to say in accounting, what's the name of accounting for capital? We call this, okay, the correct, okay, let me rewrite. The perfectly correct answer, which is how it's called everywhere, is called bank capital. Bank capital. And we call this in accounting, what's the name in accounting for capital?
Equity.
Equity or owners. Owners. Equity. All right. Well, I've been just teaching the other students, so I figured that they didn't know why this doesn't move. What are the equity components? What are the equity components? Elements. What does the equity consist of?
Asset,
liability. No, asset, no liability, something else. What are the components of equity? Yes, perfect answer. Paid in capital. Okay, what else? Profit, huh? Profit, loss? Again, I heard it somewhere again. Who said it? Retained earnings. Retained earnings. Retained. Earnings. Okay. Now, retained earnings include profits, okay, and losses. Okay. So let's go back. This loss and profit goes into owner's equity under retained earnings. So now let's write it out. Bad debts, rising debts, lower, let's write it out, retained earnings, which in turn, lower arrow, which lowers bank capital. Okay. Now, bank capital can shrink. Okay? So, we call this availability of bank capital. This applies for any business. And you should study in accounting for any business, not just bank, solvency. Solvency is the ability to service your all of your obligations. You're solvent when assets exceed liability. Let's write it out. Solvent means assets greater than liability, which is the same as equity is positive. That part tends to be?
Sure. Bank capital go down.
Yes, bank capital go down and solvency goes down. Okay. Now, next step. Insolvent. Now I'm changing the name. a business. Could be a phone shop, could be a university, could be a bank. Any business entity is considered insolvent when liabilities exceed assets, or the equity, we say, is negative. Then the business is insolvent. Now, elementary finance, I'm coming back to around your question. Cash determines liquidity. Liquidity means essentially the ability to convert an asset into cash. An asset is more liquid if it's easier to sell close to its price. Right now, very liquid are dollars. They are cash. Gold is relatively liquid. And illiquid is stuff that's highly customized. My shirt and other stuff is. In other words, remember how we said liquidity is essentially nearness to cash. What we discuss when we discuss money is how marketable and how easy the asset is. In other words, rice is very liquid, oil is very liquid, gasoline is very liquid, electricity is relatively easy to sell. In other words, it's the ability to convert quickly to cash, and cash is the most liquid of all assets. Okay? So, cash and, we say, reserves determine, okay, I'm running out of space, but I'll try again. Let's get back to answering your questions, which are important finance questions that I was teaching, was planning to teach in the second half, but we might as well get on early. So, the two primary characteristics of stable and sustainable commercial banks are liquidity and solvency. Liquidity is determined by the size of the reserves. Which equal cash and pay attention, Fed funds, I'll just shorten it to FF, Fed funds. That's already, I wrote it somewhere, right? So that's what determines liquidity. And solvency is determined by capital, which is exactly the same word for equity, which is affected by profits and losses. Okay, and now we get to your question is, losses are determined for a bank mostly by bad loans or bad debt. And profits are determined by, as I already wrote,
interest
loaning up. Okay, let's write this again, the step. Interest by loaning up. Okay. So, banks must maintain liquidity in order to survive, and must maintain solvency. A loss in liquidity and possibly becoming illiquid is called liquidity risk. Risk is the risk or the probability that liquidity will drop dangerously low and endanger the survival of the bank or financial institution or any other business. Okay, it could be any commercial business. And this one is called solvency risk. Is that the risk that bad debt and rising losses will reduce equity and turn eventually the financial system, sorry, bank, insolvent. Okay? So, bad debts affect solvency. They affect liquidity very little in the sense they affect liquidity that you expected the loan to be paid and the loan wasn't paid. Okay? So, you don't have money coming in, you don't have a cash inflow. Okay? Your reserves don't increase. Okay? But when you don't get paid, the reserves don't go down. So, your reserves remain the same when you don't get paid. Okay? But your equity falls. And to maintain the system stable, they say liquidity risk is lowered with required rates of, required reserve ratio of 10% or more. Okay. Reduce solvency risk, they have now is called a brand new name for banks only, it's called capital ratio. But in other businesses and in financial statement analysis, it's called equity ratio. Okay? Equity ratio. And usually is about 10%. Sometimes they require 8, sometimes they require 10, sometimes 12. Is good enough for today? On Friday.